Should psychology and psychiatry be involved in the use of state power? Let's look at integration versus separation arguments. On the one hand, as the first lecture made obvious, the questions of the legal system are at bottom psychological questions. Not only can psychological and psychiatric knowledge and research warn us about errors, it is also where the most basic and applicable relevant questions about consciousness, influence, perception, memory, competency, and capacity are being systematically addressed. On the other hand, the judicial system is not just one of the three branches of the Canadian government. The executive and legislative make law, but the judicial system, through its interpretation of laws, holds authority to detain and deprive Canadians of their rights and freedoms. If I tell one of my sons he can make the rules, but the other that he can decide what they mean and how they get enforced, I think we know who has more power. The term for this is judicial supremacy. Judges, as per our parliamentary democracy, are trained in the law and are appointed and potentially removed by mostly elected officials. Psychologists and psychiatrists study something other than law and are not accountable to voters. An analogy that may give us pause comes from Thomas Sass, an influential writer and scholar so disenchanted with psychiatry that he teamed up with Scientologists. Sass said that the psychiatric expert is analogous to the religious expert. There is no doubt that she's expert in her field. The question is, should her field be granted authority or status in the legal system? Should individual psychiatrists have state-like authority over individuals to confine them? If she thinks you may, in the future, unintentionally harm yourself or others, should she have authority to sign a certificate that forces police to detain you? Psychiatrists and other medical doctors have this power. Their predictions regarding your future responsibility for harm are enforced. Those of clergy, rabbis, and imams are not. Why? The SAS perspective sees the special place of psychiatry in the law as an unearned vestige of naive appeal to authority. In the 1800s in Canada, to get a controlled substance from an apothecary or a druggist, you were required to provide a note from a physician, surgeon, or some priest or minister of religion, because these were the people who had insight into your character, whether it's safe to give those substances over to you. Today, we give the druggist a note from a physician. We can ask, why did we drop the priest or minister? Sass asks, why not drop the physician? What insight do they actually have into your mind or soul that the priest or minister did not? To admit or consider the question is not to come to any particular conclusion. I use the contrast between these two perspectives, the more credulous perspective, of course the courts need psychology, versus the more skeptical perspective, psych experts have not earned their authority, because regardless of which one we take, the following is true. Psychological arguments and experts are used in court, so we at least need experts to help us sort the good psych from the bad. That is, even if the only good psych experts are the ones that tell the courts why they shouldn't trust psych experts, we still apparently need at least those psych experts. Kind of like how John Connor needs the T-800, not necessarily for his psychological insight, but for protection from his brethren. Hopefully, those who thought I was overselling psychology and the law in the first lecture will now consider things balanced.
This whole thing should be.
More formally, in Canada, we have the following standards for expert testimony in court. If the Crown or defense wants to bring in an expert on psychiatric or other matters, the evidence or expertise that the expert provides must be reliable, and the following criteria, called the Mohan criteria, must be met. First, what the expert knows and says must be relevant to the specific fact being tried or established. Second, their testimony should be required. That is, the expert should not simply voice common sense. The court does not require an optometrist to tell them that it is difficult to see in the fog. Third, the value of the testimony or facts for determining the case should be weighed against the possible prejudicing effects of those facts. If the accused was also accused of other crimes in the past, this may be relevant, but it may also provide too effective a smear. It may distract too much from the specific facts being tried. There may be specific things that the court determines are off-limits to discuss, and the expected contributions of the expert would have to be checked against these things. Fourth, the expert must be qualified in the specific area or fact being discussed. And the Supreme Court of Canada has also added that the expert must be impartial, which is easier said than done in the social sciences.
While statistics as practiced by most social scientists in Canada is largely a waste of taxpayer money, sound and swagger signifying little and buttressing bullshit, the methods themselves are not to blame for this. And in fact, they are far and away the best tools that we have for preventing the proliferation of empty and biased nonsense that, on the surface, one might blame on the statistics themselves. Just like opposing sides in a battle might firstly think that God's on their side, and secondly be savvy enough to tell their soldiers this, and thirdly not learn from having lost battles that God may not in fact be on their side. Just like this, so too, researchers with ideas at stake will think that statistics is/are on their side, be savvy enough to report to others only those results that are apparently on their side, and they'll get very good at blaming imperfections in their measurements, rather than learning from those measurements and their results when their wonderful ideas are not supported by the facts, as they themselves observed them. It's frequently not the case that researchers understand the connection between the advanced methods used in testing and the conclusions that they draw from the results. And I'm not complaining about this. I'll tell you why. What does this mean for us? What does it mean that people do not seem to have a coherent plan or logical understanding of their own work? It means, thanks to the fact that research must be communicated thoroughly to be published, it means we can know more about someone's research than they do, if we are simply literate in the statistical methods they use. We can even come to infer some of the researcher's biases that may not even be known to themselves by pointing out uninterpreted results, tests not taken, misinterpreted results, and where persuasive urging or moralizing language has been used to mask the fact that we can recognize weak or ambivalent results. A scientific method is with us because it is stronger than nonsense. Contrary to what the precious egos would like to believe, if something is nonsense, even if that something is precious to us, the scientific method can reveal it as such, as nonsense. By requiring methodological rigor, we protect ourselves from nonsense. But only in the long run. In the short run, we need to, at the very least, follow Sturgeon's Law, which says that 90% of everything is crap. In the short run, we are stuck with nonsense that says scientific right on the box. But so long as proper methods of reporting are adhered to, we can say, like the wise Zen master, we'll see.
As a little boy, on his 14th birthday, he gets a horse. And everybody in the village says, how wonderful the boy got a horse. And the Zen master says, we'll see. 2 years later, the boy falls off the horse, breaks his leg, and everybody in the village says, how terrible. And the Zen master says, we'll see. Then a war breaks out, and all the young men have to go off and fight, except the boy can't because his leg's all messed up. And everybody in the village says, how wonderful.
And the Zen master says, we'll see.
We'll see about your results. Maybe. The scientific method lends legitimacy to nonsense. But its requirements, the requirements of the scientific method, are by far the best tool for catching out that nonsense in the long run.
What you will typically see, even in Canada, is reference to the U.S. Doebert criteria, which notes that reliability can be said to exist when the referenced research is peer-reviewed, it meets standards of falsifiability, so it's not just confirmatory analyses, and has been measured to such an extent that it has a recognized error rate, and it adheres to whatever relevant professional standards exist. Whatever the established standards of the relevant field happen to be, it meets them. This report from the National Academy of Sciences took a giant sledgehammer to forensic science generally. Not to any psychological tools like profiling or advising specifically. In fact, the only substantive mention of psychology is to suggest that, quote, research programs can benefit significantly from work in observer performance in diagnostic medicine and from the findings of cognitive psychology on the potential for bias and error in human observers. The one-sentence summary of this report is that the only forensic investigative tool that actually meets the Doebert known error rate criterion is DNA testing. In other words, nearly all forensic science has not been proven fit for the courts. Note that this is not to say it has been proven unfit.
Not the difference for me. Mark it, please.
And work has been done since. There have been great pieces published on tool marks and shell casing identification, subdisciplines that never really bothered to publish or make known their error rates, simply because they had not needed to before. Judge Edwards, one of the co-chairs of the report, commented, quote, "I think that the most important part of our committee's report is its call for real science to support the forensic disciplines." So these are forensic psychology's neighbors. But this report is not even about psychology, and the syllabus topic for this lecture is police psychology.
I have practically zero regard for what is physically printed on the pages when I go to work. It's a problem.
Most of us would tend to think that the source of stress for officers would be occupational, related to what they have to do. One makes no friends issuing traffic tickets, reminding people with loud subwoofers that their neighbors also have a right to enjoy their lives, or being called to help settle disputes that grown adults should be able to handle by talking to each other. One would also expect officer stress to come from more dangerous duties, like having to chase and wrestle suspects, keeping in mind that even if suspects are unarmed, you are wearing a gun, a taser, pepper spray, which, if they get the upper hand or are agile enough, could become theirs. In general, you are expected to walk toward situations everyone else walks away from. If someone is throwing their feces at passersby or spreading it on themselves, it's your job to approach that situation. And that situation may be preferred to the more ambiguous ones that officers have to enter, like domestic disputes or bar fights, which officers will have very little information about before having to get involved. Who's the perpetrator? How do you restore order and assure it will remain restored when you leave? Who's lying to you? These are the acute stressors that we have PTSD and sympathetic arousal models to help us explain. These constitute major events. But as we know from other stress research, everyday hassles have more to do with mental and physical health than major events. This appears to hold in Canadian police services, where it is not these occupational stressors, but rather organizational stressors, that appear most predictive of stress and poor well-being. Inconsistent or ambiguous demands and expectations and bureaucratic layers tend to be at the top of the list when we ask police and their families about stressors. So it's not surprising that the structural and procedural solutions that social scientists suggest we impose on police services might not be met with enthusiasm, but rather dread, skepticism, or cynicism. Administrative bureaucracy is hell. It is where responsibility, good intentions, and reason itself, i.e. the ability to map one thing to another, go to die. Ask a survivor of communism or fascism about bureaucracy. They will be able to relate it quite directly to things like people being imprisoned despite not a single person involved in the process knowing what for. The Ukrainian genocide, where people who were making the Soviet Empire's food were starving to death, and to an increasing inability to change things for the better, despite each new added bit of bureaucracy being added to make things better. But there's a simple solution. We just need an office of bureaucracy and efficiency. All other offices should give reports to it and submit to audits and amendments that will create secondary evaluation processes and standards assessments to ensure policies follow the office's new directives and procedures. The point here is not to mark the dystopia Canadians may or may not be making for ourselves. The point is that if you fancy changing the system, it takes more than the right moral posturing and naive belief that academics can or should dictate what professionals do. Good intentions enshrined in policy may be preventing more good people from doing good than they are bad people from doing bad. With this, we come to police discretion. Police officers are held to a high standard of conduct in part because they're expected and permitted to use discretion. This example shows the extent of that discretion. If an officer apprehends someone for a crime, they can use their judgment to let the person go. Minor drug offenses, moving violations, and disorderly conduct likely provide good examples of cases where officers may choose to let perpetrators off with a warning. But this discretion must be defensible, and the reason that the officer would give for letting the perpetrator go must be convincing. Letting a speeder off because they are your family is not a good reason. Letting them off because they were not speeding excessively or had justification for speeding would be a good reason. This discretion, therefore, is an expectation of sound and upright judgment, not a granting of power.
I am the law!
If it were simply a granting of power, then officers would not be sent to court for perceived misuse of their discretion, which, as you can see from the example, they are. In this vein, officers are also what we call mandatory reporters. If their family members break the law, they're expected to report it or have a reason better than, well, they're my family, for not reporting it. This would likely be most salient in examples of suspected child neglect or abuse. Officers are expected to report even suspicion of it to relevant community organizations, even or perhaps especially if the person under suspicion is close to them. So we have, enshrined in law, high moral behavioral standards for officers. On another level of analysis, we expect a lot from them cognitively, in part because their cognitive errors can have a big impact, and in part because the atrocious cognitive error of one officer tends to be generalized and applied to all officers whenever a case is in the public spotlight. Memory issues will be more specifically covered in the next lectures, but this is a place for us to introduce heuristics and biases that are relevant to all of us and of special concern in police decision-making and training. Unfortunately, the literature and its commentary tends not to distinguish between good bias and bad bias. Looking at the description for contextual bias here, for example, it assumes one can somehow know what information is extraneous. We would need a system of good biases in order to help us determine that. You are free to believe that bias means bad thinking. In fact, you have likely completed anti-bias training that requires you to provide that answer. But in the big tent of psychology, bias is bad is only one take on the concept, a sliver of what bias is or means. Prior learning or beliefs that tend to guide you in a given direction might guide you in a bad direction, but does a bias toward interpreting all of your prior learning and beliefs as pointing in a bad direction point you in a good direction? Is a bias toward thinking all biases are bad good? If so, we have a contradiction. If no, then what other positive biases might there be? Biases are important and some are bad, but they're not all bad. If an investigator for some reason expects an individual to be guilty, this may, if Kassin and Company's research is relevant, moderately influence, i.e. alter, the material actions and decisions of that investigator. Specifically, when interviewing individuals they expect are guilty, investigators may be more likely to ask questions that imply the suspect's guilt, invade the suspect's personal space more, engage in a manner that observers rate as more coercive, and in their final analysis be more likely to conclude guilt when the suspect is not the guilty party. To help us get a more nuanced look at bias, let's jump into a research study by forensic psychology researchers. Korva and colleagues wanted to see whether images of people's faces would influence decisions people made as mock jurors evaluating a trial. Firstly, they needed some stimuli. They needed faces that were typically rated trustworthy and faces that were typically rated untrustworthy. And this is easy enough to assemble. One simply gets a whole bunch of pictures of faces and asks research participants to rate how trustworthy these faces look. It actually only takes 1/10 of a second to come to their determination of whether the face looks trustworthy. In other words, if we give individuals more time to look at the face, they don't come to a different conclusion. So Korva and colleagues ran what they called an initial pilot study, which was just to establish their stimuli. In other words, to get a bunch of faces that people typically rate or respond to as trustworthy and a bunch of faces that people typically respond to as less trustworthy. And the beauty is, even people who are rating everyone as trustworthy, unless they're consistently rating the maximum amount of trustworthiness, they're still going to have some variation in their scores. So let's say you're very nice and you rate nearly everyone as trustworthy. So let's say you have a scale from 1 to 10 and the least trustworthy person that you ranked was a 7. And you ranked a bunch of people as 10. Even though you're saying that everyone looks trustworthy, you still have some range in your scores. In other words, these are relative scorings, not absolute scorings. Someone doesn't have to be rated as actually untrustworthy to be relatively untrustworthy, according to the rating system. In our example, we had someone who was a 7. Now, 7 out of 10 is quite trustworthy, but that person is relatively untrustworthy, or is the least trustworthy person, according to this rater. The researchers are running this initial pilot study because we know from decades of prior research that if you give one sample a bunch of faces to rate according to their trustworthiness, then the next sample that you give the same faces to will typically give very similar results. Individuals in the bottom third of trustworthiness, or of relative
trustworthiness for the first sample of raters will typically also be in the bottom third of trustworthiness for the next set of raters. That was step one. So if you have a more symmetrical face, you'll be seen as more trustworthy. If you have a face more like a baby's, you'll be seen as more trustworthy. And people's trustworthiness ratings will strongly be correlated with their perceived attractiveness of the person that they're rating, the kindness that they perceive in the face of the person they're rating, the aggressiveness and potential to commit a crime. Step two is to get a second bunch of research participants. So the first bunch was just part of the pilot study in order to establish our stimuli. We take the highest trustworthy rated faces and keep them, and we take the lowest trustworthy faces and we keep them, and we throw out the middle third. So this new set of participants, now that we have stimuli for them, are going to tell us a whole bunch of things about themselves. They're going to fill out special surveys and questionnaires assessing their level of confidence in the justice system, their vengeance emotion, their level of racial bias, and their scores in terms of social justice orientation and fairness orientation. I should note here that of the 98 participants in the study, 79 were female, in part because it's psychology undergrad. Step three is when the participants are actually engaging in a task that we're curious about. So they, as pretend jurors, get to read a file, and they have to come to a decision about the case. There were four different types of cases. So there were two serious crime vignettes, one that was a robbery and a murder, and the other one was a violent attack resulting in murder. And there were two less serious crime vignettes of car theft and fraud. For each of these vignettes, there were 11 pieces of evidence that constituted the case against the individual, or all of the facts that were tried. But in all cases, the 11th point, the last point, was what the authors called thoroughly exonerating. So one example of these thoroughly exonerating statements is DNA evidence from underneath one of the victim's fingernails did not match the accused. So that is thoroughly exonerating. That certainly would throw reasonable doubt into play here. In other words, for every case, the decision that all participants should come to is that the individual is not guilty of the crime. All faces, all individuals should be found innocent. They are all innocent faces. Moreover, when they are deliberating, we have on a screen in front of them a reminder of how reasonable doubt works. But of course we know that there's going to be tons of mistakes made, in part because of those other 10 evidentiary points that might work to convince people that there is a case against the individual, despite that one thoroughly exonerating bit of evidence. Of all the variables that were measured and manipulated, what predicted people incorrectly finding the individuals guilty? The severity of the crime didn't have an effect. So whether it was the two serious or the two less serious crimes, there wasn't a significant difference in the number of errors made. The gender of the face also did not seem to make a difference. In other words, people are not more likely to find females guilty or females innocent compared to males, at least in this sample. Regarding the variables that we measured with our surveys earlier, if individuals had more confidence in the justice system, then they were more likely to find untrustworthy-looking faces guilty. Those higher in vengeance emotion were also more likely to find untrustworthy-looking faces guilty. Those higher, relatively, in racial bias were, rather predictably, more likely to find untrustworthy-looking faces guilty. So if you are very low in racial bias, you have about a 20% chance of finding the untrustworthy-looking faces guilty. Whereas if you are very, very high in racial bias, at least relatively according to this scale, then you are nearly 80% likely to find an untrustworthy-looking face guilty. But of course there's a flip side to this, which is that those higher in racial bias are more likely to make more accurate predictions regarding trustworthy-looking faces. As your racial bias increases, you are less likely to incorrectly find the trustworthy-looking faces guilty. And the authors make a point of noting here that all of the stimuli, all of the faces that they used in their stimuli were white. This was in order to avoid confounding with racial bias. So they make the note that this wouldn't have been racism. It would have been the superordinate category of racism, which is judging a book by its cover. Those higher in racial bias are more likely to make the error of judging a book by its cover. Or in the author's words, a more general tendency to make unfounded inferences about defendants. What about a different type of software? What about higher social justice orientation or higher fairness orientation? Well, this group is making more accurate decisions regarding untrustworthy looking faces as their social justice or fairness orientation level increases. So they go from roughly 80% likely, those on the low end of social justice slash fairness, or at least the relative low end of it, have about an 80% chance of finding an untrustworthy looking face guilty. But as you get higher in the scale, up to the highest, you get down to somewhere between 30 and 40% likely to find the untrustworthy looking face guilty. But it's not all sunshine and rainbows, because those with higher social justice or fairness orientation were were more likely to find trustworthy-looking faces guilty, going from roughly 35% likely to 45 or 50% likely. In the author's own words about those with higher fairness orientation, individuals who strive for objectivity may overcompensate in an attempt to make a fair and unbiased decision. These individuals may be overly conscious of the need for objectivity in legal decisions, which may be potentially biasing their verdicts in the opposite direction. So all of the faces should have been found innocent. They all had one thoroughly exonerating detail. Appearance, in actuality, was not related to guilt or innocence, so it should not have been related to decisions, but it was found across all conditions to be influencing. Even those with high fairness orientation were influenced by the faces, by their assessment of how trustworthy the faces looked. It should have been irrelevant. It should have been treated as irrelevant, but it was not. Those running racially biased software were more likely to wrongly convict untrustworthy-looking people as their racial bias increased, but as their racial bias increased, they were less likely to find trustworthy-looking people guilty. And those with higher social justice orientation tended to wrongly convict trustworthy-looking people as their orientation increased, but they did much better as their orientation increased in reducing their error regarding untrustworthy-looking people. In the author's own words, untrustworthy faces activate personal biases related to the importance of appearance-based assessments in legal decisions. The subsequent tunnel vision reduces the likelihood that exonerating evidence will be considered in evaluation of guilt or innocence, which may ultimately contribute to wrongful convictions. And this is regardless of the type of software you're running. Even those who specifically make an ethic of being fair and just are influenced by the faces that they see. In addition to making a similar rate of errors, they were similarly prone to make their own type of errors. In other words, nobody escaped the power of the prime. The faces they saw, their symmetry, their baby-facedness influenced everybody because we are all human. We are influenced by irrelevancies like a picture in the corner of a page, and even what might be called the more enlightened of our philosophies, the more compassionate, the more deliberately fairness-seeking of our philosophies, can't entirely avoid these simple priming-based influences. So,
we have judicial cleansing as a solution for the biasing effects of eyewitness testimony in court proceedings. How do psychologists help with biases in the investigative process? Some solutions are painfully obvious, like avoiding memory errors by writing things down, which may be better advice for investigators than it is for witnesses, and what I would call multiple perspective taking, to avoid confirmatory search or interpretation. Other approaches seem a bit more like make-work projects for psychologists and make organizational stress projects for officers. And take a moment to consider the value of this. Creating a layer of bureaucracy responsible for deciding what information an investigator should or should not have access to in her attempt to crack the case. I do not doubt that this bias-preventing information czar's existence would be useful or protective in some cases, some of the time. But at what cost? Just reading this sentence should hurt the brain of a reasonable person. Blinding precautions involves the investigator being shielded from information that is not directly relevant to the interpretation and evaluation of physical evidence to reduce the influence of extraneous information. However, blinding precautions may interfere with analysis, so it may be preferable to control or restrict the flow of information. Let's fix what follows this coordinating conjunction, so that it follows from what is indicated by this conjunctive adverb, however. There we go. If, dear watcher, you think I'm being too cynical about important efforts people are making to improve things, I can summarize my position like this. Making another layer of people to tell other people what to do, or think, or determine what they're allowed to know, is, in my estimation, going to reduce the freedom and responsibility of individuals to make good decisions, and drive the people most inclined toward freedom and responsibility away from police services. Both of these results would reduce the net number of good decisions made in police services. Perhaps I am wrong about the relation of bureaucracy to freedom and responsibility, and perhaps police services should be ruled by intellectual philosopher kings with the best ideals and most perfectly designed systems of information control. Perhaps I need to spend time in the Ministry of Love, but for now, now I'm skeptical, not cynical, but skeptical of most approaches toward change. Not because I do not share the goals of better decisions and a more just society, but because I see a lack of attention to the downside of intervention, a lack of perspective taking, and in some cases, an outright hostile bias toward those trapped in the Kafka nightmare of not knowing when and how they are free to act like humans, like independent moral agents, allowed to do good or to fail and take responsibility for it. We will be circling back periodically to issues of bias, but I wanted to end with a discussion of the big bias, confirmation bias.
This is summarized from Adam Benfredo's book, Unfair. A man is found one evening, lying dazed on the sidewalk of a wealthy neighborhood. He's trying to stand, but he keeps falling backward. He's unable to use his left side. He keeps hitting the back of his head on the sidewalk. He seems disconnected, unable to respond to questions, and he has no wallet. Emergency services are called. As the firefighters arrive, the man vomits. The person who found him suggests to the firefighters that he might have had a stroke. But firefighters see the vomit and smell the alcohol and say, 9 times out of 10, it's alcohol-related. They stop the bleeding from the man's head, but don't perform the standard assessments of blood pressure, heart rate, and breathing, even though the man's pupils are constricted. A police officer arrives, and the firefighters tell him it's a man with no ID, possibly intoxicated, who fell and hit his head. The officer doesn't follow protocol of securing the scene and determining whether a possible crime occurred. And then the ambulance arrives, the firefighters tell them we have an ETOH, which is code for ethyl alcohol. The firefighters don't pass along the pupil constriction information. The EMTs load the man into the ambulance. They don't follow procedure, which is that a senior EMT examines the man. Instead, an assistant performs the neurological assessment. The assistant EMT finds a 6 out of 15 on the Glasgow Coma Scale, which is a priority 1 score, but classifies the man as priority 3, or stable. His inability to speak, his poor eye and motor responses are all attributed to alcohol. Further cognitive tests and normal protocol aren't continued. Due to being designated ETOH and his low priority coma scale of stable, the man is not taken to the nearest hospital, but rather one twice as far away. He's dropped off as quote-unquote a drunk. The hospital places him on a gurney in the hall. The coma scale information, the actual initial information that was changed, isn't passed on. The basic intake assessments aren't performed on the man. And the first time an emergency room doctor actually looks at the man, she decides to just return later when the nurses will have cleaned up his vomit. 8 hours after being checked over by the firefighters, the man dies of a head injury. He'd been hit by a bat on the back of the head and robbed. But we only know that this is what actually happened because one of the robbers thought they would be caught and confessed to it. So let's look at some of the biases involved here. First of all, a very important thing, especially for the police, was that he had no wallet. That's something that should have caught the officer's attention and at least gotten him to do his job of securing the scene and seeing whether a crime had taken place. We can file this under what you see is all there is. Vomit is the presence of something. No wallet is the absence of something. So all the emergency responders were biased towards what was present, namely the vomit, which has high saliency. He threw up? Yeah, that's what drunk people do. 9 times out of 10, it's alcohol-related. Now, this is a bias of framing. Yeah, 9 times out of 10, it's alcohol-related, but you're emergency responders. You're kind of there for the 1 in 10 times type of situation. So if you just say, well, 1 in 10 times, it's something more serious than alcohol, well, that changes things entirely, even though it's the same information. But in part due to this framing bias, the firefighters don't perform the standard assessments. In other words, they don't look at the part of the world that could disconfirm the story that they have, that it's just an alcohol problem. So information that could change the story doesn't get sought. But wait, they did notice that the man's pupils were constricted. Why didn't they make that part of the story? Our name for this is belief perseverance. The constricted pupils should directly disconfirm the idea that it's just alcohol, should show us that there's more happening here. When we ignore or underweight such disconfirming information, it helps our initial belief persevere or persist. The officer doesn't follow protocol, and protocol would, presumably, have given him a chance to find out that a crime had occurred, so file this under confirmation bias. The firefighters, despite noting it to themselves, don't pass along the pupil constriction information to the EMTs. They don't tell or share the part of the story that could disconfirm their neat ETOH explanation. The EMTs accept the firefighter's story and break procedure under the assumption that it's not a serious case, and then continue to very seriously not treat things seriously by deliberately ignoring a priority one score on the coma scale and changing the standardized empirical results to better fit the firefighter's story, perhaps an even better example of belief perseverance. Now, you also have facts that could be explained in multiple different ways being attributed to the alcohol. So these don't constitute neglected disconfirmations, and they're not evidence necessarily in favor of the alcohol hypothesis. So attributing these symptoms to alcohol is what we call biased assimilation, interpreting neutral information as support for whatever theory you have going. And despite the coma scale results, which were ignored, the EMTs didn't do further tests that they could have done, which were normal protocol or procedure. The procedure and the tests exist because they're smarter than you. That's why we have them. Just like the firefighters before them, the EMTs don't pass on to the emergency room information that goes against the just a drunk narrative, illustrating confirmation bias in the same way. The firefighters neglected to pass on the pupil constriction information, the EMTs neglected to pass on the coma scale information. So the emergency room is now primed to continue with the same confirmation bias that started with the firefighters. Intake assessments aren't performed, and then the ER doctor takes for granted that it's not an emergency and decides she can just return later when the man's not covered in vomit, perhaps overweighting what is present, the saliency of the vomit. And again, we only know that this is what happened because somebody confessed to the crime. There wasn't good police work behind this. Aside from having a reputation that scared the perpetrator into confessing, the police did nothing to earn this detection. A general observation here is that most of the errors we observed, and they were many small errors, many measurable little errors that occurred, were people not bothering to falsify, test, or challenge whatever story they were given, whatever story they believed because of what was immediately in front of them. Quoting Mark Twain, "It ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble. It's what you know for sure that just ain't so."